Welcome to the Stoa. The Stoa is a digital campfire where we cohere and dialogue about what matters most at the knife's edge of what's happening now.
Okay, I'm starting to recognize some faces. Unfortunately, I will never remember your names if I ever run into you, so I'm going to apologize beforehand. I remember, this will date me, but I remember when Facebook first started and I'd go to these conferences and people would run down the hall and go, Bonnitta, Bonnitta. And I thought I was like losing my memory because I had no idea who they were. And I never like really hooked it up to the fact that they were my Facebook friends. This woman, Piper, you have a beautiful screensaver shot here. I have a little duck named Piper. Okay, are we on? Mm-hmm. So we can, you know, some of you have been here for, you know, for a couple of weeks in a row. We can build on what we've been doing, but I just also wanted to get some idea of maybe you have questions or where you want to go or what is a conundrum or something that you might be holding about what we've been doing. I just want to open it up for 10 minutes or so into that kind of exploration so I can kind of pinpoint where we should be headed for next. Last week we worked with inner talk and tried to demystify it. Was your experience of that, did your experience of that give you an insight or something that you hadn't thought of before? Or did it confirm what you knew? What was your experience of that? Was it obvious to you beforehand? Are you skeptical about? Yeah. You can just unmute yourself and.
I mean, I'd never really thought about it before, but something I've always been aware of is not so much the speech, but the earworms, right? I don't know if I'm particularly susceptible, but I pretty much all the time, every day, have some kind of tune playing in my head repeatedly, the same sort of simple tune over and over and over again. I don't know how common an experience that, I mean, I know everyone has it to some degree, but for me, it's, I mean, I live alone and I work a lot, you know, just quietly in the garden, whatever. And I pretty much always, as I say, have some sort of little tune going through my head.
There was something that I wrote down last time that resonated, that you said that curiosity doesn't have to turn into inner talk, because inner talk was too coarse grained. But I don't know exactly, I don't know, I've been thinking about that a little bit, but I don't know exactly what it means, actually. Or I do, but not completely. So yeah, I just wanted to bring that up.
Yeah, so what is inner talk good for? Inner talk is good for simulating and experimenting with what you're going to say. If you need to run it by, you know, if you're going to go on an interview and you know they're going to ask you about your last job, you might want to use inner talk to simulate, to experiment with what you're going to say. So all this inner visualization is the same way. There are ways to simulate. If you're looking at a carpentry problem, you could do something trial and error, or you could, if I put that there, oh, then that'll go there, or rearranging your room, right? You can start to solve 80% of the problem by simulating it in your mind. This is also how, for example, retraining athletes, you simulate, or dancers, you simulate the choreography in your mind, your retraining pathways. But to think of, to solve complex problems, where you solve the complex problem is not in the language. The language is a pretty coarse instrument to solve a problem. So Eugene Gendlin, for example, he talks about, gives the example of a poem, of someone writing a poem. And let's say about someone they love, or someone they knew, or someone they lost, or a garden that they were in. And they think, beside the tree, there she was. It was, and there's this sense of something they're trying to say. And they'll use a word, it was marvelous. And they're like, oh, that word's not right. And then they'll use another word. So they're actually measuring the word against a deeper knowing, right? So the deeper knowing, Jen would say, is more precise than the language. So what does that mean then? What it means is that, how do we work with the deeper energy? And that is all about intention. So you set an intention to figure something out, or you set an intention to solve a problem, or you set an intention to change your life. And you stay with the intention, stay with the intentional motivational state, and that keeps priming the system to solve it at these deeper levels. And then every once in a while, you check in, you know, and do you have the language? Do you have the inspiration or the insight to move the needle to the next step? And then once you have enough of that, you might have to fiddle around with it again in explicit space. But it's this back and forth. We all know that this is part of why taking a walk, all of a sudden you'll remember something you forgot, or you'll solve a problem, because you're letting the process go back into the implicit processing. So but the question then is, why do we have constant inner talk? Like, why, for some people, let's just raise our hands. Who has inner talk probably 90% of their conscious day? All right. Who has it more like 70%? And how about under 40? Yeah, so some of you are at 60-ish, 50, 60. Some of you are at 90. So that's something interesting to notice, and interesting to ask yourself the question whether it serves you or not, right? Now, if you're at 90% and it's carrying all your ideas forward, that's awesome. But if you're at 90% and it's the same thing over and over and over and over and over, or some version of the same pattern, then maybe you'll want to work toward releasing that habit and instead working with intention. So if I say, what do I really want to do with my life? Let's even hook it up with coronavirus. We have an opportunity to do something different with our lives. What do I really want to do with my life? You want to just get a very, very, very strong kind of a determination. That you want the answer to be given to you, but you don't want to think about it. You know, you don't want to be going, well, you know, my father always said, you know, this and on and on and on. You want to set this deep kind of energy signature. And then as thoughts come up, it'd be like, I always wanted to do, like, you know, these thoughts come up. I always wanted to do that. And then you feel into imagining what it's like to be that. And you'll feel whether it's too much of an idea. You know, sometimes you think, oh, I'd like to be a movie star. And you know, it's just a fantasy because it's too much thought and it doesn't really sit with that intention, doesn't match that intention. So then you release that and you might wait for years, but that's better than stringing yourself along with these, this, what I guess Jordan Hall calls, what's he called? Simulated thinking, right? It's all simulated thinking. It's a kind of energy. It's an energy that we need to displace. We do it by talking. So the question is, you know, can we relax into the intention? That's kind of an interesting phrase because the intentional and motivational state has got a lot of energy to it. But can we just relax, meaning relax this mind into this bodily sense of intention and determination? Can we sit with that? You might have to go so far that you don't even have an intention or determination. So you have to get underneath that and sit with the fact that you don't have an intention or determination. So you can, if that doesn't arise, you can, you constantly want to go underneath as far as you need to go until you really feel like you're touching where the energy is sourcing itself. For some people, it could be lower chakra and feel very sexual. Then, oh, that's interesting. Here's where the energy is coming from. You don't want to get it too fast into a story. Like, you know, a lot of times when you're meditating, that energy, it'll start to manifest in the lower chakra. And then people say, oh, you know, the story, you'll play a TV story in your head. I got to go get a girlfriend or I got to get a boyfriend. You know, that's how we displace that energy. That energy is like a nuclear reactor. And if we don't have the capacity to hold or be with it, then it goes into these stories and these kind of simulated thinking, thought patterns. Then we get into the stories and the stories make us and stuff like that. So it's just the energy has to go, the energy is like a nuclear reactor. It wants to be, you know, I talk about it as a car, you know, you have the energy as the engine and it wants to be attached to a transmission so it can go somewhere. And that will happen automatically in these kind of habitual ways if you can't contact the source and then with intention and determination, attach it to the transmission that you want the energy to be in service toward. But if we rush too fast to make meaning out of it, it'll be this mental talk. That's another thing, you know. You'll notice one year at the farm here, I mean, we have a lot of animals and we had a lot of older animals and, you know, like two chickens died and then a horse died and then a dog died, like five animals died in like 4 years. And even though we know they were all older and stuff, you feel your mind like there's something in the water. There's literally all these stories come up because you want to make sense or meaning out of something that is doesn't really have that meaning. And you could notice how when things are emotional or when you're starting to tap into the depths of your feeling tone, if you can't really be with that, you'll start to make surface meaning. That's one of the ways in which the energy discharges. Now, it's a good thing because you want to wonder, is my well poisoned? I mean, yes, thank you for serving up these things, mind, but it's none of those things. It's just grief. It's just the energy of grief. want to go into this kind of surface meaning making. And so these are the ways the energies are coupled in ourselves.
I'm really feeling the connection to working with myself and other people, using tools like Doug Tatron's biomotive framework and internal family systems, and where there's, yeah, seeing myself and others struggle to go into that under level layer and just want to stay in the sort of the words and the stories. Yeah, just resonating a lot with that.
Yeah, so what we're going to talk about today is what's underneath the words and the stories. I mean, not necessarily like inner talk or earworm stuff, you know, that stuff's just kind of like, I don't know. But today I want to talk about mental models. Well, they're called internal working models. When your internal working models are highly conceptual, they use the term mental models. When your internal working models are based on stories and relationships, they call them internal family systems. They both operate the same way. The way they operate is by organizing reality into a familiar model. So conceptual people will usually use a lot of conceptual terminology. Imagistic people, like I use the car, the transmission, that's more of an image. I could have used concepts. You could also use family systems. And family systems. So they're all what are called internal working models. Now, what's interesting, so what the reason why they're deeper and lower is because once you get rid of the inner talk and you're accessing some of the deeper motivational or determination or felt sense, you start to see that they have a structure that's built up on a mental model of reality. Right? So, and you can get at these mental structures through certain methodologies like internal family systems, etc. But one of the problems with them is they're a horrible reduction of reality. A mental model is a construct or a container which doesn't let all of reality in. And so they limit your freedom, and therefore they limit your ability to be creative in your intentional and motivational sensing. So, yeah, Nate?
When you were talking about trying to tell yourself a story about the farm animals, I was thinking about how, well, two things. One, the idea that we make sense of our lives looking backward, but we have to live them going forward. And then also, John Vervaeke talks about how narrative is a psychotechnology. And I'd never thought about that before, that we are taught to tell stories. And I wonder to what extent, like in that situation you're talking about, that we have this tool of narrative that's so powerful, but then we want to over apply it to everything.
So I'm going to let your question steer around a little bit. So language is funny for us, because if instead of telling a story, I was making artwork, right? Like abstract artwork, not artwork that basically tells a story. Like some artwork is so literal, right? Let's say all that was processing in me became the artwork. I wouldn't relate to that artwork the same as a theory of everything. If I had a theory of everything, I would relate to it as this wonderful expression of a part of me. And this is the problem that we have with narratives. We tend to not see them or allow them to be these fantastic creations. We want them to be the final word, or we want them to, you know, transcend and include everything else we thought. You know, it would be like an artist, and I guess there could be movies about this, who wants, doesn't like any of their paintings because there's one really big painting that's going to include all the other paintings, right? This is the structure of our mind in Western culture. It's not the structure of everybody's mind, but pretty much everybody is cosmopolitan these days. So the Buddhists talk about the mind as an organ of perception. So they say, for example, it's not all the Buddhists, it's a Sotrantika's school, but it's a really beautiful way to think about the mind. And that is, they'll say like there's eye consciousness. So that's a perception, right? And then there's ear consciousness. And then there's smell consciousness. They have these, the senses are a type of consciousness. But then they say there's mind consciousness also. And for them, the mind is part of the team. For us, the mind trumps the team. Like for us, we take in all this perceptual information, and then the mind is supposed to say what that all means, right? So the Sotrantika say what the mind's consciousness is, it generalizes. Like the ears hear the sound, the mind says bird. That's all the mind does, bird. It doesn't matter if it's a red-winged blackbird or a bluebird or whatever, it's a generalist. And so the idea is it's good to have a general perspective, but it's only one perspective amongst the others. Whereas the way we relate to the generalist is that it transcends and includes all the others. When the larger ideas should just be another perspective in our constellation of perspectives. So when we create mental models and theories, it's as if they stand in for everything else, but they should just be another tool in our toolkit. Some of you have been watching me on Facebook, I've been getting into trouble. So a larger understanding of coronavirus needs to be in your information ecology, but also the anecdotal evidence that contradicts with it. We use our mind as if a more sophisticated perspective includes all of them, and it doesn't. It's a different type of perspective than all the other perspectives that we need to include. This is the problem with systemic thinking, what I call synthetic systemic thinking, right? So to have like a kind of ecological management systems orientation to the environment does not include all the local knowledge that the indigenous people have. It doesn't. But we relate to those types of systemic models as if they sum up everything. It's a valuable perspective to have, but it's just another perspective. It's another organ of consciousness. And this is what we need to understand about narrative. A narrative is a powerful exploration of reality, but it needs to be on the same team as all the others. And most of our narratives come in the form as if they're the trump card. Now, this is true for what people go through. You might have heard of Keegan and the self-authoring person. This is a late stage identity, ego identity of the authoring self. The self-authoring self identity is very reliant on what I call autobiographical coherence, the narrative. So if I ask you, if we're really going at it, we're on the different page with coronavirus, you will be arguing from this sense of autobiographical coherence. I lived my whole life this way, and I'm a researcher, and then I've done all my due diligence and all this stuff. You will be in the perspective dictated, shaped by your need for autobiographical coherence. So you will resist my perspective because I am in arguing for my need to be in autobiographical coherence. And this is the last identity before what you would might call some kind of individuation or liberation. So this need for autobiographical coherence is symptomatic of a late stage identity. And I think this is what's break, you know, this is what's being challenged in our modern, in our recent times. When your story of self can't address, doesn't give you the answer to what you should do next, you start to see the story of self itself is a narrative or a mental model that's partial. If when people ask you, tell me something about you, and you have this like, you have to pause because it should it be this thread or should it be that thread or should it be this thread? And you realize over time when you're answering the question, you kind of morph it and you make it up. You start to realize there is no autobiographical coherence. It's just like the same question. Why are all these animals dying? Why am I here now? Your mind is just serving up things that are like, make you feel that things make sense or that you can make sense out of them. So this is part of the narrative structure. This is somebody is writing, I think, to everyone. It should be a personal note. Okay, so this is part of the narrative structure or one of the mental models that shape us at a deeper level. So we can't, even when we're trying to figure out from this deeper knowing, we have to be careful or vigilant that we're not subject to the constraints of this mental model. So here's one from internal family systems. Who believes they have an inner child? Okay, so that's a limiting belief. It's a mental model. It's a thought. It's a construct. Who's paid people to talk to their inner child? It's kind of ridiculous, really. Many of the biospiritual trades, they're in the process of creating the structures that then they help you resolve.
Could I ask you a follow-up question about that?
Yeah, that was a provocative one.
What would you say, like, okay, so for example, in a depth psychology perspective, there's these inner structures that have been shaped by so whatever, right? Whatever the narrative is, like evolution or some spiritual boundaries that shape the way that we perceive, or even like a phenomenological, just a purely philosophical endeavor to uncover what the structures are that we use to perceive things. How do you feel about how our ability to articulate those is a narrative that then becomes a mental model that's limiting us?
Yeah. So this is a very good question. Thank you for asking it. It's helping me move along in the right direction. You know, I don't know a lot about all of you. Okay. There are psychological structures. And it has to do something with how we were talking last time about burning and downward causation versus upward causation. So the earliest, the primitive brain of the child, and what I mean by brain, again, is the whole shebang works. The gut, the vagus nerve, the affect systems. And if I use the word brain, it means that whole thing, right? So the core self is a sensory motor self with human potential. So it basically has an animal's perception and body plan, but it's more sensitive to relational dynamics with its parents, let's say, right? So if you know anything about chickens, the chickens are born, they have horrible mothers, but they can eat right away and they just take care of themselves, called precocious. But ducks, they have really beautiful parents. And the parents protect them, right? They're more precarious existentially. Ducks are more precarious existentially. Turns out there's a relationship between ultimate pro-social behaviors and sophisticated consciousness and the precariousness of the sensory motor system with respect to how it's cared for early, okay? So that's how we're born. We're basically an animal with this potential that makes our socialization much more sensitive and precarious. So the first thing this animal has to do is it tries to structure reality, because unstructured reality, as James said, is like, you know, an LSD trip or worse than an LSD trip. You couldn't get any handle on anything. And the first thing that the core self has to do is create a structure called self, other, and world. That's the primary structure, the primary organization, the primary internal working model of the child. Now, I'm going to tell you how that happens, but this core structure changes as we develop. You know, once when you get into high school, you're starting to ask questions about, is that the world in my mind or is that in another person? You know, these morph and get this organization, this fundamental organization, can change over time. But for the child, this is how the structures are created. It's about, has to do with what's called variance. This is very well researched now. It's a new field, but it's called variance. So what co-varies with me, what constantly comes with me, is me, self. What responds to me but varies, like my mom, she's always responsive, or my dog, there's like something responding, but it varies, is other. And things that are invariant, like no matter how many times I hit that wall, it does not move or respond, that becomes world. And this sets up the primary psychological structures. The psychological structures are the way the primitive minds, it's the primitive mind's internal working model. So this enables us to figure out a lot and to be socialized. As an aside, what's interesting is one of the hypotheses out there in this research is that kids that use simple interfaces like iPads and screens. Let me say this and then I'll get back to the question. Because the interfaces co-vary, then you get this fusion of self and technology. This is actually what they do when they do these virtual reality out-of-body experiences, because the thing you're looking at is co-varying with you, so you think you're ahead of yourself. So this the hypothesis is this is creating psychoid type pathologies in young people, because there's too much of a fusion between technology and the self. Now, this person, yeah, so Velf van Horen. So I did, remember I said that the construction changes? So it can change in magical experience, with nature mysticism, but it also can change as you grow spiritually and you see the construction itself is up to, has certain choice in it, right? You see those boundaries are not that clearly delineated. But if you grow up in our society, then you tend to not see the tree as co-varying because our language takes that experience away from you. But later on, these categories change again. And there's a point in young people where there's a lot of reality testing. This is, you know, these boundaries are themselves, they're conditioned and they can be deconditioned. But the normal Western child has this, certainly a certain basic plan. I think we're all, you know, and which construction of self or other world is our fundamental one depends upon what gets affirmed in our culture and what gets kind of like, oh, that's silly, you know, it's just a tree kind of thing. Yeah, but those constructions are still made in all human beings, self, other world. So that's the, we're gonna get to the inner child, okay? I guess that's where we're going today. So yes, Nate, there are psychological structures. We call those psychological structures because they're not conceptual, but it's the same, the sophisticated mind creates more mental models and the primitive mind creates these feeling tone kind of expectation, perceptual sensory motor models, which we call psychological structures because they're not sophisticated mental models. Now, the thing about it is they're very hard wired because anything earlier, everything else gets built on it, right? So our language and our abstractions and our science gets built on some fundamental things. And then when, if you're taking psychedelics or in meditation, or if you're having mystical experiences, you start to see that those are somewhat optional, that they can be rearranged and still make sense. They just make a different kind of sense. And just to drive it home for some of you psychologists out there, if you know affect regulation theory or attachment theory, when the mother is too blended with the child and when the child's scared, the mother gets scared, there's not enough variance. And so you get certain psychological structures built that are considered not normative. If the mother doesn't vary at all with the child, like if you just put them on a strict schedule and if they cry, they cry. And then when it's time, you know, that then the mother and other people seem like world and you become a sociopath. So the relationship to the primary caregivers can create these pathologies of self, other, and world. If you're too blended with the other, or if you think other people are like world, you become a sociopath. They become object-like to you. This is also why children who live, you know, this is also why, I won't get into that, but that was just a peripheral that doesn't make sense. Okay, so you're starting to see how this works, right? Now, so self, other, and world. The other thing, the child, the other thing is sameness and difference. It's almost like the same way of languaging, co-varying and varying. So once the second thing the child understands is what it feels like. You know how we were talking yesterday, last time about when the mouth moves, the ear always hears the same thing. So there's these packages of experience that are structures in psychology. And one of the packages is if you live in a highly gendered family, this person, this other always feels like this, and this other always feels like that. And these get hardwired as internal working models. This is the formulation of male and female, or masculine and feminine gender identities in the internal family system. Now, what's fascinating is as the gender roles become more fluid in society, you start to see more fluid gender structures as internal working models in children. It's the same, it's how we say the same thing. So that's the second, that's another, and some of this is fluid, some of it is roles in society. If you have a highly gendered family society, and some of it is kind of biologically innate. If you want to believe, if you ascribe to that. So then we start to have the triangle. We know self, other, and world, and when then we make a distinction between if they're gendered roles, the two selves. Now, gender is a funny, so I would say instead of gendered role, isomorphic roles, because for example, I have gay friends who have children, and one just takes on such a traditional mother's role. They stay home, they cook, they're the ones they go to when they cry. And the other one goes to work and makes money. So this is not a gender category, but it's an isomorphic role, right? Does that, everybody understand that? It doesn't really have to do with your sex. It has to do with highly isomorphic roles in the nuclear family. Okay, so so that's the next structure the child makes. There's this thing happening over here, isomorphic. There's a different thing happening over here. And it's like a triangle. And I'm the child at the base. This is the first family system. Right, that I am part of this triad, and this down here is called the child, because all the attention and protection, this one's protecting me, this one's nurturing me, or the protection and nurturing is what happens. In a highly gendered family, the male becomes the protector and the provider, and the woman becomes the nurturer and the safety. But this is all kind of changing. And that structure then is what your inner child is. It's you sitting at the base of these two categories. Now, what we tend to do when we are looking for partners, and we're thinking of it in terms of family, men tend to look for nurturers, and women tend to look for protectors, because we think that's the, you know, Pythagorean shape of family. And so you start to have people dating and putting kind of expectations on people to be part of this. The real problem with that is that you're basically playing the role of the child when you look for your partner. So when you're a child and you have this structure, this three-part structure, that's a beautiful thing. It organizes reality. But if you're 20 years old, you don't want to be organizing your reality on the basis of a mental model that's appropriate to a two-year-old. This is the problem. Now, as we create, as children create more and more organization, they understand when they get to be like 4 years old, their psychological structure that's important to them is the role. They start to understand the mommy has a role, daddy has a role. They start to play doctor. They start to play fireman, trucks. They really understand that you can step into roles. It's also where they start to step back into the role of the petulant child because they understand it as a strategy. They really start to understand that these roles come as packages, and you can start to see them. These are also internal structures that can be, that are part of the way the child organizes their reality. But the problem is that if they're not constantly upgraded or updated, you'll always think the doctor is this, the way you thought a doctor was when you were 5 years old. And you always think the policeman is this, and you always think the president is this, and you always think a man is this, and you always think a woman is this. And these categories have been created when your mind was very primitive, when you couldn't reason, when you couldn't be creative about the nuance of the human condition. And that's what the psychological structures are. They're deep internal working models of the way life is. And if you're really honest with yourself, we have no freaking clue of the way life is. All we can do is try to organize some sense out of it that's relevant and useful in our situation. So would you say that a psychologist of spiritual teachers often is a different range of mind, comes with a different set of feeling tone? Can you ask that question, like in conversations, a big question?
Sure. I was just wondering basically whether you're saying something like I think Jung, for example, might say that the father mother archetype, you know, becomes this like sky king, sky queen in terms of the whole civilization, and that's why we create religions, something like that. But you're sort of suggesting that actually it's just a working relationship that the child has created with reality, because that's the way it is for a lot of children. So how would you think about wanting to deconstruct that, for example, and build something that might be more appropriate in its place?
Yeah. So the process of individuation is the process of dissolving these structures that stand between you and reality. So I remember the first time I actually saw my father. It was after he had a heart attack, and he was in the hospital bed, and he was like a little Frenchman. I never knew he was little. Like literally, I could not see that he was a little man. Until then, you see through the archetype. You actually never see the individual in front of you. I work with women who will say, first things out of their mouth, they'll say, I never intended to marry my father. And I'll just cut them off right there. You didn't marry your father. The only thing that's the same between your husband and your father is they're a man. And everything he does, you put in that little toolbox called my father. You literally cannot see the individual who you're married to. Literally, you know nothing about him. And then of course that puts him in a box where he becomes what your father is. So this is the problem with the archetypes and these primitive structures that are, you know, people pander to in the spiritual community. They're constraints. They're necessary for the precarious existential condition of an animal born as with a human potential. But they live in the past. They live in the past. Now, in terms of archetypes, I'm gonna give archetypes a really bad rap here. I'm in a bad rap mood today. What's it Peter Lindbergh said? Trash talking. He and Saru were trash talking. So I'm gonna trash talk the archetypes. A partial perspective, but it's one that no one really sees. I mean, you know, Jung is very controversial. Everything someone says, somebody else can say he didn't say, or vice versa. But before there were archetypes, there were allegories. Does anybody know what an allegory is? So the before civilization, before what Jung called mythopoeia, when the archetypes started becoming conceptualized more as internal models, like the king and the queen, there were allegories. And if you read indigenous people's stories, for example, they're all allegorical. So like the wolf, or the coyote. The coyote's a really bad fuck. He eats everyone's babies, he lies, doesn't show up on time, he shapeshifts. But when coyote's in trouble, what do? They go help him out. And you think, what? You see, the difference between an archetype is that in an archetype, the coyote would be the epitome of evil, and then there would be good on the other side. The archetypes emerge in culture with the dualistic consciousness, in Platonic consciousness. Before there, there were allegories. And in these cultures, in the early mythologies, you know, the early mythologies, like Zeus wasn't the all-powerful person. Like, he would do things and he would fuck his daughter and turn into an animal, and the animal would get eaten. All this like weird stuff would go on. Much, much richer appreciation of life as it is. The archetypes are reductions, symbolic reductions. But in indigenous and these other kind of foraging tribes, these early cultures that have remained today, I mean, they're so more sophisticated now. That's not how their stories go. Their stories go more like social media and the coronavirus. Really, truly, that is actually more how their stories go. And part of our, I think what's being asked of us is how can we become more real in this information ecology. It's actually perhaps more real than the bubble we've been in. I mean, some people are saying coronavirus is a good thing. That's like saying coyote is good. Like, maybe it's a good thing. So this is kind of like trying to, what's being at, these internal working models are no longer adequate to the transparency of the world. And so these deeper structures are things to really be mindful of and see if they're helpful and see when they're limiting. And you can do this, like, for example, if you've ever told a story about your childhood, I mean, there's certain stories you tell and you like, it kind of like presents your parents. You know, I was born in an Italian family and every night my father, blah, 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 blah. You tell this story over and over again. And then at a certain point in your life, you realize it's not a real story. Like, you realize it's not really how it happened. And so this is this the point about, you're always retrospectively generating the past, so it fits with your idea of who you are now. And then there's a question of whether the past can ever be recaptured. We can't ever know who our parents were, really, when we were young, because we were too young to know who they were. We can only try to know who they are as individuals today. All the rest is just internal churning. It's a deeper level of internal talk. It's a habit that goes around and around and around at this more subtle structure of psychological structure. Yeah. So conspiracy theories are part of this need for us to make sense of the world. One of the things that's interesting about conspiracy theories, I hate the term. A lot of when the mainstream explanation doesn't make sense, this need to make sense This is what arises spontaneously. And the way I would like to see, I would like to see all these ideas and questions enter the information ecology and constellate. How can all of this be happening at the same time? How can one hospital be overwhelmed and 65% of the hospitals be under, be laying off people? How can we state that, those two things simultaneously? And then what is the relevant or the adequate response to that? And yeah, so in the sense that there's some kernel of truth in every conspiracy theory is because someone is speaking of their experience, first of all, whether it's correctly or not correctly interpreted, but also there's a sense in which it's a ritual response. Like you feel some threat, you feel some confinement, and you're gonna respond in a ritual or archetypal way. And what comes out of your mouth is like some kind of, you know, construct that may be over the top. The aliens brought coronavirus down or something like that. But I think we need to be able to learn how to live. We learn how to let go of needing one narrative to connect all the dots in the social, the ecology of information, and let all of it interplay different degrees, and then move from a place of response. It's kind of an unknowing, really. The biggest thing is to let go of when you can't have a predictive narrative, when it is uncertain, is to let go of the need to settle for, you know, a story that trumps everything. So Pradeep says, so once we have dissolved these psychological structures, we proceed non-conceptually to replace them with better distilled models. Yes. So is that a question or a statement, Pradeep?
No, that's a question. So obviously this is super, super interesting. And I also love like the cutting through of the inner child structure right there. But at the end of the day, what is the next step? We dissolve them, but I'm sure they're quite useful to construct reality with. So my question is, do I eventually become completely non-conceptual and receive everything? But my intuition says that that might make it really time consuming to be able to respond to reality. So I would need to create some shortcuts, some new conceptual scaffoldings.
Yeah. So, there's always an ability to touch with those structures. I can get into my inner child, but I don't think I have an inner child. I think I'm downwardly causate, just like, you know, we said we could do that. I'm reanimating the pathways that are the inner child. And I also know I can tell when I'm putting too much story in it. I'll tell you how I can tell I'm putting too much story in. I feel the violin strings. It's too sentimental. Children are not sentimental about themselves. You see the difference? So I can get in touch with my inner child, but I know when I'm storying it because I feel the little violin strings happening. Children are not sentimental about themselves. So you start to relate, you start to make these distinctions in what's being constructed. I went through a point in my life when I was first with my partner that I have now. We went to visit his family on Nantucket, and it was one of these beautiful, I mean, we went way out on the beach. There was one of these beaches with no one there, and the sunset was amazing, and they had a carnival there. And his two girls, when I was a kid, I loved the merry-go-round because I was too much of I didn't like the scary rides. And his two daughters, my husband's brother's daughters, went on the merry-go-round. They're really young and they're on the merry-go-round, and it was the sunset and the beach and the new, my partner was my new boyfriend and the whole thing. And I had a meltdown. I had a meltdown watching them on the merry-go-round because I thought, they're so happy now, and between now and when they grow up, all the pain they have to go through and the tragedy of it was just overwhelming, right? That's the little, there's a story. I put a story on top of what it is to be a child, like the little backwards, too much of that. When that little violin plays, that's enstoring things. So that's part of it, is you start to utilize these, I call it subpersonalities or transitional structures, just like when you get pulled over by the cop, right? I know what to do with my body. You know, I can just step into that little role, but I feel the creativeness of it. I feel the optionality in it. So you do have those, but what you lose is this need for biographical coherence. All those options are no longer threaded by something you really believe in. And you start to, I know we have to go soon, and you start to hear people stop. When they're in autobiographical coherence, this is for those of you that are working like this, the person coming out of autobiographical coherence will start to use the term, what's the authentic self? You see, they're still looking for a structure underneath the autobiographical coherence. Now they know the story's not real. What's the authentic self? That's the last ditch attempt for someone to find a thing that is their self. So in like the people I teach, that's a lot of where people always, so we have this transpersonal module called authenticity in the generative self. We move from the sense of an authentic self to the latent generative self. The process itself is authentic, not any one of those stages. So you start to see when that question arises, it's an unsolvable question because you're still looking for a psychological structure that's the authentic self. The authentic self is not a psychological structure. It's the thing that capable of generating structures and organizing reality. And then on the other side of it, people start talking about they use it language, like they think that, you know, it's not up to me. I'm a vehicle of evolution. I'm being used by a bigger process. I'm an instrument. So the notion of trying to find something in the psychological structure gives way to, you're just part of this larger movement. And so that's kind of where, and Nate asked that, that's kind of where that kind of spiritual technology happens, right in those stages there. And that's how it typically arises.
Yeah, thank you for that. It's super, super helpful. And sort of rounds up to your initial comment, right? Because you spoke about intention as a way to channel the energy. And at that point, the question that came for me was, if I'm looking at an unfolding system, how can I enforce a preconceived intention? Because that was creating a friction between how my energy wants to flow versus what I think it should flow like.
Exactly. Yeah. You know, so this is why I really appreciate the questions, because there's many forks into the conversation. But yes, that's one of the traps. That's why I said you have to get deeper. And you can start to taste the energy of the thought or the, I, you know, it'll be different for different people. For me, it's always the violin. It's always got to have something too sentimental. That's a little habit. Although there's authentic grief and stuff too. But you start to realize that where the when the trap is being set for you by your ego. You get snookered. Okay, well, this was a big dive. Lots of very sophisticated ideas in this conversation. So just let it live in your imagination and don't try to jump down to it as too much of a thing. And I'm the host now, and I want, my duty is to remind you that the Stoa is a place of dialogue around what matters most at the knife edge of history or something, consciousness. And we operate on the Gift Society. And this is being given to you as a gift. Your presence here is already a gift, but if you choose to support the Stoa, there's some way to do that, and I haven't learned about it yet. There's a link somewhere. So thank you very much. Love you all.